Hello everyone, John Hardy here with the FX update on February 8th, a Tuesday. Just a note before we get started, thanks very much to all you Twitter followers out there. At John J. Hardy is where you can follow me on Twitter. I do post a number of updates intraday on commenting on levels and when interesting fundamentals come out, if there's something interesting to comment on there, as well as stories I'm coming across that I think are relevant. So feel free to join in the fun, and if you have anything you'd like to ask me out there, just feel free to send it along. I'll try to get to whatever I can. A great day today. I really like today. Very interesting interesting developments. We had China out with the PBOC hiking rates 25 basis points at the end of their Chinese New Year holiday. Rate hikes very much expected. Timing, of course, was uncertain, but it was very evident that they were going to hike soon, and that hike did happen overnight. The lending rate up 25 bips to just over 6%, deposit rate at 3%. And the interesting thing here being that we get back to Chinese, the Chinese markets open again starting tonight, Wednesday in China. And the longer term question, though, being if they're able to engineer a soft landing. The response to the global financial crisis was some pretty desperate measures in terms of easy credit, hyper-expansion in infrastructure, and these kinds of overcapacity-generating policies. Tremendous imbalances. Let's see how this plays out. It's a big question mark we have on the ability of the global recovery to continue much beyond the medium term. And, of course, even for the near term, seeing how the Chinese are able to engineer this this landing. Very key year with a five-year plan on the way, new five-year plan, and a leadership change there. So let's keep an eye, always keep an eye, one eye on China. Market reaction, though, we had a brief risk sell-off, and then the market kind of shrugging its shoulders a bit, as it did in the last couple of Chinese hikes. Still, I would say the implications longer term, very important. Also today, of considerable import was the U.S. Treasury auction. This is the first auction this week. Today it was three-year Treasuries auctioned. The yield was a tad higher than expected, something like half a basis point, so not a huge development there. However, the very low foreign demand, I think it was something like 27% versus much higher the previous time. In fact, that was the lowest foreign demand evident at an auction since May 2007. So this is, of course, a big concern. And this saw U.S. rates higher. Interestingly, the dollar responding positively because of the interest rate implications here as treasuries are selling off. But, of course, the logic escapes me a little bit here. If we're worried about foreign demand, which is the only thing propping up the entire U.S. interest rate curve and the ability of the Fed to or the government to continue to spend its money, shouldn't we be worried about the dollar? That doesn't matter, of course, for now, the market says, but just a philosophical question on that account. Yields were higher all along the curve. As I said, this is being taken as nominally dollar supportive. We'll get to the charts in just a moment. And then looking ahead, this was a three-year auction. The really important stuff is up tomorrow and on Thursday with the 10-year and 30-year auctions. Let's see how the demand does. You got to remember the 10-year yield is over 3.5% relative to this 1.3, this piddling interest rate at the short end of the curve. So with 10-year interest rates and 30 interest rates much, much higher, I think the demand equation from foreign buyers is more interesting there. And we are in new territory on the 10-year and yields going back quite a ways, and everyone focusing on that 4% level as the next huge area, as we showed you on yesterday's video. Weekly, ABC Consumer Confidence is up after the close at very interesting levels, and I'll get to that in a moment. I won't talk about it here, get to that in a moment, because of its implications and as a coincident or confirming indicator for the employment, for the U.S. job market. There's a whole lot of debate going back and forth about the quality of the surveys and whether this shows that or whatever. I think we look at a broad spectrum of inputs. We can get a pretty decent picture, but I'll get to that in a sec. Also important, with Australian dollar trading so high against the dollar, interesting, I think, to see the Thursday employment report out of Australia. And then, of course, the weekly claims data on Thursday out of the U.S., and I think the trade balance is up on Friday out of the U.S. Spending way too much time on this stuff, let's get to those charts. But actually, first, let's go to that confidence a chart of confidence versus employment. And we see here is an inverse of consumer confidence. So as it goes up, confidence is dropping. That's on the right side. And the lowest reading was just below 30 on the Conference Board Consumer Confidence Survey. It's since come back to about 60, and that's close to the highest level it's had, the best level it's had for the cycle here since the global financial crisis struck. And you see how the confidence really starts going into action before the unemployment rate swung higher. So I think it's important for us to see, as a confirming indicator, to see this confidence survey start to show better levels. Now, this includes only up through December, so we need to see a February reading. We saw the January reading. We need to see a February reading. The more frequent, highly frequent, and again, here we saw the consumer confidence coming off before the unemployment rate actually rose. If we go to the weekly one, sorry for my tripping over my words here, we see, again, confidence coming off before the unemployment rate responds. And we are seeing that weekly survey back towards its best level since the global financial crisis. It's the red line here. The lower it goes, the better it is for confidence, because I've inverted the y-axis here, and that's what we're looking for. We need to see this drop, folks, if we want to see the U.S. employment rate really start to improve. But they're very much coincident indicators. And regardless of how people talk about statistical manipulation, this is critical stuff for better news going forward. Okay, charts. Eurodollar, back off today. You got sort of three time frames with conflicting impressions here. On the daily, you could say it's somewhat bullish because we've broken back above this key pivot line in the sand, 134 plus, and we need to break back down through this area to get a bearish indicator. However, when we go out to the weekly, we had a very bearish weekly bar with the shooting star here with a nice tall shadow on that candlestick. So that's still in place. We need to see confirmation of it. And of course, confirmation could come with a break through this area. That keeps us capped on the weekly view. And if we go down to the hourly, we could say there's somewhat a degree of bearishness as well, having not been able to sustain the new highs here. And if we do a Fibonacci retracement, actually, we never did a full Fibo retracement. And back to the standard 6.8 levels, etc. We peaked out today at around the 50 area. But looking in the next, more tactically in the next couple days ahead, I would say this 6.18 to 7.64 area is what we need to see capped if we want to see your dollar lower. An interesting area that needs to stay in place, I think, to keep the shorter term view bearish as well. So sort of conflicting on various time frames, but overall adding up to bearish with unconfirmed bearishness, if you will. Now, of course, with the auction underway, we're always talking about rates versus dollar-yen. So let's look at what the dollar-yen chart is doing. Very interesting day for dollar-yen. We had the big bar on Friday where the trend lines was survived and we saw a nice engulfing bullish day. This old Ichimoku cloud level still getting in the way, still not seeing a confirmation higher on dollar-yen. But that auction helping sort of throw a rope to dollar-yen, if you will, as it was much lower ahead of that auction, and the higher yields mean the interest rate spreads are widening out in favor of the dollar. And if we look at, we talked about this morning, and we posted this chart this morning as well in our written FX Daily, the spread at the front end of the curve has really shot out wider in favor of the U.S. dollar lately, towards the highest level since last, we'll call it July, here on the spreads. And around that time frame, we're trading closer to 88 to even 90 on dollar yen spot. So clearly, if these interest rates continue higher, there's a lot of pressure building there. We either need to say the dollar yen currency pair needs to close the gap or to come up with an explanation why this very tight correlation has suddenly become has widened away and started to diverge from the underlying behavior. Okay. Oh, and on that note, same thing with Kiwi dollar. We see it back towards the high of the range. We're wondering if this has something to do with flows and the whole food inflation story or what's going on. But the actual interest rate spread very low relative to Kiwi's the interest rate spread for the recent past. So this is very interesting as well. on Eurodollar, we have a picture of it peaking out and coming back lower. We also have the sovereign CDS prices looking a little bit worse for the PIGS countries. That's capping, providing some fundamental grounds for capping of the Eurodollar cross. And we saw quite a rally in Euro sterling today. Not sure what that was about. There is some small improvement in the spreads in favor of the euro, but the reaction short term seemed a bit excessive. I think they're still quite very much in the shadow of the recent sell-off, the recent drop in spreads. So let's wait to see if euro sterling still survives this little rally here. Back to the charts. Other interesting things we wanted to discuss today. Dollar Swiss. We've been talking about this for a while in terms of its structural situation here, and that this rally saw a retest, and now we're seeing it come up through the trend line from here, which I haven't drawn on this particular day. I had it in place yesterday, but we're seeing this beginning to break 55 day here. Very interesting on Dollar Swiss. I would say with interest rates going higher, also just like the dollar yen, the S&P not expected to go anywhere, and interest rates very low there. The differentials add up to like an extreme widening for the U.S. versus Switzerland, so some pressure on the fundamental side on that account. Also, to help out with a bearish Swiss view, we've talked about for a short while here, we have a big break in Euro-Swiss today, which looks pretty nice on a technical basis. If you'd be looking now for as long as this new high holds above 131, we'll have the level 131.80 or so, towards the 200-day moving average, well above 133. Goodness, this is getting to be a long video. Let's try to wrap things up quickly. In other news, Aussie dollar still up high there with commodities going crazy and risk appetite still very healthy. Haven't seen much of a follow-through yet, and I think that's very interesting. Maybe we're waiting for Thursday's report. The interest rate spread suggests we should be higher, but not necessarily at new highs. So let's wait for that Thursday report, see what the reaction is off of that. I'm kind of in limbo, losing a little momentum, but of course a break would be a break, and a reversal would be a reversal. So I think parity and the 102 level closes on either side of that. I think interesting at post Thursday. Finally, let's look at Dollar Canada, where we're getting some pretty good confirmation of the double bottom here, where this turned out to be a false break. Still, though, that parity level looms is an awfully important resistance level. We'd like to see, oil coming off, but interest rate spreads are supporting this pair higher. But need oil lower, we need risk appetite lower. And, of course, with risk appetite still just chugging higher and higher every day, it's difficult to call for a huge consolidation in any of the commodity currencies. Finally, on a note that's supportive of the Aussie and of in some other places, huge move in the precious metals complex today, especially silver, which is actually getting close back to that all-time high. Silver a bit more closely related to the copper price because those are found in the same deposits. Okay, so this is stretching into a record-length video here. Just remind you to follow me on Twitter for further comments, John J. Hardy. And that's it for me today. Over and out.